back with yet another exciting episode of Rick's Horror Review Show. That's Rick's made it our horror documentary review show where we review absolutely everything and anything that is related to horror. Horror movies, horror TV shows, horror documentaries, horror primetime specials from the 1990s featuring...
I'm Barbara Walters.
And I'm Hugh Dow. Of course, we also reviewed a horror experience down in Mexico. And we did the top 10 horror gimmicks in all of wrestling because around here, we absolutely love that shit. But if I am honest with you, and there's one thing that you can count on from me and this show, not entertainment, no, it's honesty. There tends to be a particular type of horror that, I tend to gravitate towards. Not so much lately. It's kind of been having a little too much of the Catholic Church and demonic possession. But I do love my hell some demonic possession. But I also love knowing what vampires do in the shadows and zombies. I love zombie stories too. I know which is coven. But lately, been a lot of alien abduction stories. I think that's really what I'm interested in at this particular moment in time. And of course, last but not least, I also love a good ghost story of a ghost that just haunts you in the home, because you know why? Fuck it. Got nothing better to do. Can't go anywhere. It's got some unfinished business. Welcome to our show. If you are a new listener, if you are a returning listener, welcome back. We love having you here. And before I go on, and before my two producers start barking in my ears, you can't see them from here, but they are down there. Allow me to tell you about my socials. You can find me, Rick, at Rick's Horror on the TikTok. And on the Instagram, of course. And you can also find me on the YouTubes, but not on the Facebooks, because that's for the old. But without going on any further, allow me to introduce to you, the audience, the co-host of Rick's Horror Review Show, Rick's Radar Horror Documentary Review Show, Billy the AI!
Here I am, and time for us to get back to the future and travel to the year 1994, where we're going to talk about the Encounters. Episode number 2, Encounters in Zimbabwe. And it's good to be back, and let's get it done.
Indeed, good sir. Indeed, let's get it done. All right, without further ado, allow me to talk about this particular episode. We're going to talk about, as Billy just mentioned, Encounters, Episode 2. You can find this show on Netflix. And, you know, we're just going to do all four episodes because, you know what? It's our show. We do whatever the fuck we want around here. But, yes, maybe a little less of that. Encounters, Believers, Episode 2. Maybe a little more of this. No, a little more of this. Yeah. This episode will delve into one of the most significant mass sightings of alleged extraterrestrial beings, the 1994 encounter in Zimbabwe, where over 60 children, school-aged children, reported seeing a UFO and aliens on their school playground. Now, if you're familiar with the show, it goes a little something like this. We're going to talk about the facts of this case. We won't do any reenactments of the events tonight because I just didn't find the funny in this. Although, no formal reenactments, although some shit we'll come up with, I'm sure, in the midst of this that will be improv. But anyway, then we'll propose an alternative theory to what could have potentially happened that night. And I believe our camera, because it's not on, is having some technical difficulties. But we were stuck in the same image here, so we are back. Anyway, yes. So the facts of this particular case. The sighting occurred on September 16th, 1994, at the Ariel School located in Rua, Zimbabwe, which is about 20 kilometers southeast of the capital city of Harare. Now, this documentary on Netflix gives us detailed accounts of some of the children that were there that day, although it does not present to us all 60 plus, you know, alleged eyewitnesses. But these are the facts of the case as presented in the documentary. The first gentleman we're going to talk about, his name is Dallin, and is the only thing that is given to us. He's not, we're not giving a last name or anything like that, but his role in this is that he actually claims to have started the rumor of these shiny UFOs, when in fact he had simply pointed at a shiny rock in an effort to get out of his class. He proposes no observational details for us because, again, allegedly he is the one who faked the entire event. But there are other witnesses interviewed for this documentary of the 60 plus that were in attendance that day. And they are as follows. Emma, and again, most of these are not identified with a last name, only a first name. Emma Tapu Kudzanai and Sama Siddiq. Their role, all of their roles, were that they were all students at the area school at the time of the incident. All of these kids reported seeing disc-shaped crafts in the schoolyard, and they all described the beings as having large heads and big black eyes. According to their accounts, the beings communicated with them telepathically, imparting messages about environmental issues. Now, there is another, in the midst of our research, and it's still facts of the case, it's just that these were not presented to us in the documentary itself. But it's fascinating enough that I think it certainly warranted me looking a little deeper by the way. What I do for the show anyway. But there's another student that was not interviewed in the documentary, a former student, I should say, student at the time, and this happened in 1994, Emily Trim. While not featured again in the documentary, she was in fact present. She was a student at the area school at the time of the incident. Now, she reported seeing also, or rather, she also reported seeing this shaped craft in the schoolyard, and she described the exact same thing the other ones did, large, or rather, beings having large heads and big black eyes. According to Emily, the beings communicated with her as well, telepathically imparting messages, once again, about the importance of the environment. Now, why did I separate her as opposed to the other ones? She has presented art. Let's see if I can see this. Oh boy, I wanted to show you some of the images, and I know that if you're just listening, there are some interesting images that, I just want to show one image of Emily Trim's because I thought it to be fascinating, and if I can just, let me see, if I can turn this item down, here we go, okay, great, we've got it now. So here's Emily Trim, and if you do a quick Google search on her, you'll notice some interesting drawings that she proposes. different Emily Trim. Let me specify Emily Trim paintings. Ah, here we go. Now, I don't know how come you can see that. A little creepy. If you're only listening to this, I would suggest you just look up Emily Trim on your phone, and whenever you get an opportunity to take a look at the drawings that she proposed. What they tend to look like, these creatures that supposedly visited her. The interesting here is the alien creature with the black eyes. I would say pretty standard for what we tend to think of aliens nowadays. I don't think it was necessarily something different back in 1994. I think this is a standard description of what aliens have been described to look at even back in 1994. But the interesting here is the paintings of the aliens at the pyramids. Now, plenty of people will make that correlation nowadays, but in 94, was this such a common thing? I don't know. But I wanted to show these paintings that Emily made because I thought them to be fascinating. And I also found it fascinating that she was not interviewed for the documentary. Why that's... I don't know. I thought that she had, you know, the paintings themselves, at the very least, warranted her being involved in some way or another, but apparently she was not. Okay. So again, 60 plus kids claim to have seen these crafts in their schoolyard. Okay. And for the documentary, Emma Tafu, Kutnasai, and Sama Sadek are the four main ones that were interviewed, as well as the one who claims he invented everything, Dallin. Okay. But the story takes an interesting turn. Let's explore more of the facts of this case. Now, Dr. John E. Mack. Dr. John E. Mack was a Harvard psychiatrist and professor, and he was already known in his circles, psychiatric circles, for his research on people with alien, who have had alien encounters. He learned about the incident through local reports and other UFO researchers like Cynthia Hind, who had already begun collecting testimonials. Now, this was interesting enough to him that he actually made a trip to Zimbabwe to interview the kids. So he traveled to Zimbabwe to investigate the incident personally, firsthand, seeking to interview the children and gather more information about the event. He spent several days at the school speaking with students, teachers, and of course, parents. He conducted interviews and observations with the students. He, you know, obviously conducted detailed interviews with students that claimed to have seen the beings and the UFO. And he noted that there was a tremendous amount of consistency amongst all of their accounts and also their emotional reactions. His psychological analysis, he approached the case with empathy and open-mindedness, focusing on the psychological impact of the experience on the students. He was, in fact, impressed by the emotional sincerity in the children's narratives. A documentary evidence. Now, he gathered drawings made by the students that depicted the UFO and beings that he saw, or that they saw, allegedly, and recorded their descriptions in audio and video format. Some of that footage is seen in the documentary. Now, I don't know exactly how many kids he interviewed. I think he actually attempted to interview all 60 of the kids, or rather 60 plus of the kids that were in attendance and experienced this, allegedly, but the documentary only shows us the ones I previously mentioned. Okay, his conclusions and impact. Mack found that the children's testimonials were compelling, noting that they showed no signs of deceit or influence from outside sources. Well, that's very, very interesting. We have a Harvard-trained psychologist, okay? Despite the criticism that the academic community placed on Mack, he emphasized the importance of studying such phenomena scientifically, urging further research. His involvement brought international attention to the case, helping to amplify the voices of the witnesses and highlighting the need for serious inquiry into this incident. Now, one of the interesting things that happened to him is, like, you know, this is 1994. Talking about this subject, I don't think, especially if you were a professional, as he was, a psychologist, a respected psychologist, credited for starting the discipline, but credited for many contributions in the discipline as a Harvard psychologist, was not necessarily a thing that, you know, you would potentially want to do if you were in that position. There's a lot of stigma involved with talking about aliens, but the documentary also emphasizes the information campaign, or rather the labels that were adopted by the U.S. government in the 1950s to refer to people who talked about these things open. The plan of attack was discredited, called them lunatics, called them crazy, called them whatever you will. This stuff is not real. But he went ahead and did, and it was very interesting. Okay, so Cynthia Hind, or Hind, although not featured in the documentary, she was also part of the research efforts, right? So she is a local UFO researcher from Zimbabwe, and she's also an author. Her investigations after she visited the school shortly after the incident and interviewed the students. She also collected drawings and descriptions that were strikingly similar. Her analytical reviews of the events are as follows. Her initial response, or rather the initial response of the school staff were, they were initially skeptical, allegedly. But the consistency in the children's descriptions prompted further investigation. There was a tremendous amount of media coverage, so much so that obviously you got an American Harvard-trained psychologist to fly down there. The incident received significant media attention, drawing the international interest from both UFO researchers and skeptics. As you might imagine, something of this magnitude, 60-plus people watching the allegedly the same event. Okay. These are the facts of this case. Now, this is likely not going to be a super long episode. As I already mentioned, I do not have any improv stuff to talk about this evening. But I do have an alternate theory. Now, Billy, do you want to talk about the alternate theory or should I talk about it? Well, I mean, I would love to, but can you play my music? Okay. All right. Here we go. Here is an alternate theory proposed by Billy D.I. and I'm your host in alternative theory, Billy D.I.
Okay. Hold on just a second. You didn't come up with this theory. I came up with this theory.
Ah, okay. Well, can you play my music? Hi, welcome back to another exciting episode of Alternative Theories with your host, I'm Billy D.I. and tonight we'll talk about Rick's alternative theory and when he proposes that this was in fact staged and faked.
Okay, you want to talk about it?
I actually don't have the theory in front of me, so I wouldn't know what to talk about anyway.
Okay, fine. I will propose the alternative theory. No music, please. Again, this is episode 2 of Messengers on Netflix, if you watch this. Pay close attention to, and I will point this out actually, let's go ahead and bring this up on screen again. If you are not, listening, or rather, if all you're doing is listening, there is a portion of the documentary. Actually, I won't bring this up. There's a portion of the documentary where Emma, I think the first individual that is interviewed for the documentary, or at the very least in the order in which she's presented, she brings up the fact that, and obviously she's heard this from somebody, that she was very lucky to have grown in what she describes as a game camp. Now, they speak British English in Zimbabwe. Somehow the population there is 97, well not somehow, but it's Africa. The population is 99.7% black. But somehow, the super private school has a bunch of black kids, and Emma happens to be one of them. Now, why am I bringing this up? I think it's interesting that the event happened at a private school, first and foremost, and an affluent private school where the majority of the students, well, I actually don't know this, I'm not going to speculate here, but it's interesting that it happens at a private school where Emma, one of the few that people that were interviewed, or at the very least presented in this documentary, talks about how she was so lucky to have grown up or have gone to a school that had a game park next door. Now, if you don't know what the hell a game park is, a game park, and this is British English, if I'm not mistaken, sort of like a safari is what we'd refer to right here, right? There are giraffes, there are elephants, they're in Africa. There are animals native to Africa that we don't have normal access to, and this is just an everyday occurrence for her. Now, can you imagine growing up in an environment like this? This is a very rural part of Zimbabwe. I also like to bring that up. And the customs and the traditions of that part of the country. By the way, we're done with the facts. This is all speculation, alternative theory. This is my opinion now. It just seemed like a really interesting development to know at the beginning of this documentary that Emma was taught to be considerate of how lucky she was to have grown up around these creatures in a rural environment, which, by the way, upon further research, I realized that the economy of this particular part of Zimbabwe is mostly agricultural. Now, why is this important? You're talking about being visited, allegedly, by aliens who telepathically told all of these children in an area that is economically dependent on agriculture to place an emphasis on the environment and taking care of the land. And to me, maybe I'm just, again, alternative theory. What if it was just a means of teaching these young, impressionable kids about the environment and the importance of making sure that they understand that agriculture is important? Agriculture is the number one moneymaker of this part of their country. So doesn't it make sense that the adults would, you know, maybe they're very theatric, put on a show, pretend like, I don't know, maybe the X-Files were in vogue or 94. Yeah, I think the X-Files were around. I think the X-Files came out in 93. Maybe somebody at the school was watching a little too many X-Files. You know, and they're just like, okay, we're just going to, you know, let's, how can we teach these kids about the environment in a way that's not boring? Credit to them. Uh-oh. My producer. My producer wanted to say hello. What if these teachers at this school just thought of doing something that would teach the kids in a different way about the environment? And they decided to put this whole shit together of like, we're going to bring some aliens down here and they're going to teach these kids how to... Well, actually, they're all British. Yes. I've got an idea. How about we teach them about the importance of agriculture, but instead of doing some boring presentation, well, they make little tiny farms out of paper mache and pipe cleaners like they do in America. That's boring. Kids in the third grade in America, they don't know any better. But what if instead we do something along the likes of an X-Files episode where they're visited by this strange black creature and he tells them telepathically, and we'll just use some sort of bullhorn to tell them about the environment and how important it is for them to continue to take care of the land. And then somebody just said, Yes, this is a brilliant idea. Brilliant idea, I say. And that's just what they did. So I just think, by the way, let me also say this. I believe they saw. Okay, the data, the psychologist himself, Dr. Mack, says that these kids all experience the same event. Or like he concludes that they were sincere about what they experienced and they actually saw what they thought they saw. What I am proposing here, an alternative theory, is that they in fact saw something, but it wasn't extraterrestrial in nature. It was actually just a part of the teaching curriculum, and they have kept it hidden the entire time because, I don't know, it's too sensational to come out and say that, you know, for anyone to take advantage or for anyone to claim responsibility at the school. And maybe, you know, what's his name, Dallin, the one who claims responsibility for the event, is just the person who are now saying, okay, Dallin, you're just going to say you're the one who did it. And maybe that is so. Maybe there is some truth in what Dallin was saying, although he wasn't the mastermind behind the event. He's in on it. He knows because someone at school approached them and they wanted him to say this for the documentary. And that's just the way it goes. My producer agrees. Okay. The other thing I wanted to mention was the... And this is not an alternative theory anymore. What I also wanted to say that I found interesting was that the headmistress herself, I don't know, maybe this is where the alternative theory falls to the cracks. But the headmistress herself also mentioned that she was abducted. She had a close encounter of the third kind, if I'm not mistaken. The kids had close encounter of the second kind? Maybe that was also third kind, I don't recall. And by the way, this is produced by Amblin Entertainment, who is that is a company that is owned by Steven Spielberg, again, the director or producer of Close Encounters of the Third Kind. So this would, I think, qualify as a close encounter of the third kind for both parties. But anyway, the headmistress claims that she was visited, and she doesn't quite recall when she was visited, but she makes a claim in the documentary saying that she was also...
Okay.
And my producer's telling... What do you want to know? Okay. My producer's telling me to remind you about finding us on the old social media. You can find me, Rick, and my producer at Rick's Horror on the Instagram, on the TikToks, and on the YouTube. What do you think of our alternative theory? What do you think? Do you have an alternative theory, or do you believe that this actually occurred to these 60-plus children? Look at this documentary. Research, check out some of that footage, and you tell me. They look very sincere to me. They don't look like they're all lying. Although, again, I believe they saw something. I just don't believe it was extraterrestrial in origin. But anyway, going back to the headmistress, she also claims to have been visited and abducted. Not only was she abducted, she was then actually offered to leave. Allegedly. This is hers. She tells this. They offered her. Actually, she says they visited her once. And they took her up in a spaceship, and she makes a fat joke. Well, yeah, I can't believe it. They've tucked me in this little tiny skinny gurney, and I was like, how do I even fit here? Look at me, I'm so fat. And she was taken, and in the instance that she was taken, I believe it was the first trip, she talks about something I found really, really, really peculiar. And they implanted a microchip in her belly button. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but that's like a... Come on. That's kind of a trope, right? I mean, we see this in The Matrix. I mean, it's not a microchip in The Matrix. It's sort of a GPS they implant Neo through his belly button. But I mean, come on. A microchip in my belly button. That sounds a little too sensationalized for me. Too common trope for alien abductions. And what do I know? But I mean, come on, let's talk realistically about a microchip. What kind of microchip is the first question I would ask? A microchip is such a general term for things. I would say, what was the point of this microchip? Allegedly, how is it being powered? First and foremost, why implant it through your belly button? Why not just make you swallow it? There's just so many illogical things about stuff like that. So I don't really want to talk about too much about that, but the point I'm making here is she claims she was abducted once, and then they came back. They're like, hey, you sure you don't want to go with us, huh? You got all kinds of cool tech. And she denied, or she said, nah, I'm good. I don't want to go with you guys. And they came back a third time, and the third time they're like, listen, this is the last final offer. Do you want to come with us or not? Do you want to come to the big old spaceship with us? And we'll take you away, and, you'll have a much happier life. And she's like, nah, I'm cool. I'm good here. Thanks. Pass. So she makes these claims. And I'll finish off the night with this last thought. I want to go back to Emma at the beginning of the episode, where she also not just mentions that, you know, she's so lucky to grow up in this area where there's nature and there's a game park next door. But she also... She also says, when she's being interviewed, as a child, by the way, they go back to this footage of her when she's a child. They also go back to a point in which she says that these aliens told her, allegedly, that she should not get too technologized. And obviously, technology is not a word that I know. It's not about Kelly, but what she was trying to explain as a child was that she shouldn't be too dependent on technology. I think that was the message that she was conveying, or rather the message that was conveyed to her. And that is how she explains it as an adult looking back at the footage of herself as a child. But I propose this. You have, allegedly, an alien intelligence who has traveled vast distances, so at the very least, you know, it's not from here, certainly has some level of technology, telling you that you should not pursue technology? That's counterintuitive, isn't it? Like, wouldn't you think that the message would be more like, hey, technology is great, but be responsible with it. Use the technology to invest in, you know, your agrarian economy. Make your tools better. Make the working conditions for those who work the fields better. Treat humanity better by implementing technology in a responsible way. Nope! What we get is, don't get too technologized by species that have superior technology. I don't know. I just found that to be interesting. But anyway, I think that's going to be it in another. My producer is telling me that that's going to be enough. That's going to be enough for another exciting episode of Rick's Horror Review Show. Rick's Radar Horror Documentary Review Show, where we talk about all things related to horror. If you're still here for some reason, listening to us or watching me and producer have an interesting conversation about this stuff, we appreciate you being here. Thank you so much, and we'll catch you again next time, where we'll either review Hellraiser or we'll talk about part 3 of the Netflix show Encounters. Yeah, we'll see what we do. But anyway, thank you so much for being here. If you like this episode, subscribe and share. If you like some of the crazy shit that we do around here, why not? Let others enjoy it, and we'll catch you again next time again on another exciting episode. Thank you so much for being here. And my producer is just going to stay here. I'm just going to let producer. There he is.